The rules of scaling that Mr. Dennard gave in 1974, they serve the industry pretty well for 30 years, all the way from 1974 till 2004. But then they suddenly break down. So why did they suddenly break down? What happened in 2004? So let's to understand that better, let's take a closer look at this transistor. And drawn over here is the band diagram of this transistor along this vertical direction. So what Mr. Dennard required was he required us to scale the oxide thickness with every generation by 0.7. So he required this oxide thickness to scale 0.7x with every generation. So what he required was this oxide, if it's 10 nanometer, the next generation it should be 0.7x of that, that is 7 nanometer, then the next generation it should be even 0.7x of that. And this continued well for more than 30 years till this oxide thickness reached around 1 nanometer. And what happened at that point, if your oxide thickness is just 1 nanometer thick and your gate is just separated by your channel by a nanometer, this oxide no longer is an insulator. So what essentially happens is your electrons or your holes, they can easily tunnel over using quantum mechanical tunneling from your channel to your gate. So essentially you have a leakage path from your channel to your gate, and essentially you have a shot between your gate and your source drain. So it was no longer possible to scale this oxide thickness, and because of that, it was not even possible to scale the voltage. So the voltage, instead of scaling 0.7x, it just became constant. It's often said that when things start to go wrong, they go wrong all at the same time. So not only did this oxide thickness stop scaling, but also the other things which Mr. Dennard asked for us, which Mr. Dennard asked for, they also became very difficult. So Mr. Dennard asked for the diffusion regions, the depth of these diffusion regions which form the source and drain should scale along with the length and the width also as 0.7. But if you do that, then if you can't increase the doping in your source and drain to compensate for that decrease in your junction depth, your resistance which comes from your source drain starts to go up. And so your extrinsic resistance of your transistor increases, and that's bad for your on current of your transistor. Another thing Mr. Dennard required us to do was increase this substrate doping. So he required that the substrate doping should keep on increasing. And that became actually very difficult to do as well, because if you keep on increasing the number of dopant atoms in your channel region, your mobility actually takes a hit. There's also a phenomenon known as random dopant fluctuation that we'll talk about, and that also started to come into play if we march along the lines that Mr. Dennard required us to do. So Dennard scaling essentially it died in 2004, and it started a post Dennard scaling era. So in this post Dennard scaling era, the voltage could not in scale since this oxide thickness scaling was stalled. If the voltage does not scale, if we come back to this equation, we realize that the W and L scale, that's fine, but the voltage does not really scale, the oxide thickness does not scale, so our current with the scaling, it remains constant. So our current per transistor remains constant, the power per circuit, which is essentially just given our V by I. So the voltage does not scale, the current does not scale, so our power, instead of reducing by half, it remains constant. And we are still decreasing the area, so we are increasing our density by k square or alpha square. So our power density, it shoots up. What it means is now our chips are becoming hot. So this required us to put a brake on the increase in transistor performance. So if you look at a good way to measure that is measure the speed of this fastest microprocessor, and you can see all the way from 1985 till to all the way till 2004, the microprocessor speeds were going up and up and up and up, and suddenly in 2004, since you could not the Dennard scaling break down, and so you could not scale, your essentially the fastest microprocessor here was maybe between 3 to 4 gigahertz, and even the fastest microprocessor you can buy are roughly in that same range, around 5 gigahertz. So since 2004, the frequencies of our microprocessor stopped scaling. Of course, we try to make up that gap by going to multi-core, and you started seeing announcements from Intel for their Core 2 Duo and all these products to make up for that lack of scaling of your scaling up of your frequency. And Mr. Dennard, he pointed out in his article that not only it's a scaling of VG or VD, it is important, but equally important is scaling of this VT. So there were people did try to scale VT, and what happened was, since your subthreshold slope is fixed to a minimum of 60 millivolt per decade, if you scale down your VT as Mr. Dennard predicted, your passive power, which is from your I off into your voltage, it just started keep climbing up. And you can see now in around 2005, it almost became 50% or equivalent of an active power. And this is again a bad thing. So this pretty much puts the coffin on Dennard scaling, which was cruising the industry for 30 years.